Welcome, everybody, to this quickie about speed up your unit testing with the Spock framework. My name is Ben Ooms. I'm a Java software engineer working at Quintor. It's a Netherlands-based software IT company, and basically we're building cool stuff for our clients. What we're going to discuss is, first of all, of course, what is a Spock framework? I'm going to discuss some basic terminology, what will help us when we move to this presentation. And after that, discussing the terminology, we will look at some code samples. The Spock framework. Well, the Spock framework is a testing and specification framework. And basically, it's the JUnit when used for Groovy. It's following a BDD approach, so a behavior-driven development approach, where you describe the behavior of your system with a structure, you know, given, when, then. And it's compatible with Maven and Cradle, and you can use it in Java projects, of course, also Groovy project, but Java projects starting from Java 7 and higher. And you need a Groovy runtime above 2.4. So, what are the benefits of using the Spock framework? Well, it uses Groovy as a language. I also put that on a drawback, so we'll come to that later. But at least it's less verbose than using Java. It facilitates easy data-driven testing. That's actually when I started using it for the first time. I was looking to do some data-driven testing, and that's when I discovered this library. It has meaningful reporting, so the reporting of the test, but also reporting when there are failures. And also, the tests are really readable. The drawbacks, of course, you need to learn some Groovy. If you have no experience with Groovy, you don't have to fear that you need, from a Java developer's perspective, need to learn a totally different language. It's actually quite easy to get started with Groovy, even if you are using Java-like syntax. And also another drawback, and I will show that to you later, is that you need some extra setup required in Maven to have some proper reporting going on. So if we look at the basics, well, we have a test class. You must extend the specification class in the Spock language package. And so that specification class contains some useful helpers to you for our testing, and also it underwater also instruct JUnit to use Sputnik, what is a custom runner for JUnit, so that it integrates well within your build process. A test. So you have fixtures and you have features. So a fixtures is what you do to set up your test. And well, if you look at those four methods, I will show you later with a table with the JUnit variants you use to work with. But basically, you have some setup and cleanup, what is run for each, before each and after each test. And you have a setup spec and a cleanup spec. That's the, you know, before class, what you use in JUnit. Then you have fields, of course, what you use in that class. And that's quite interesting, because when you declare a field, and I will show you an example later on, is that that field is reinstantiated each and every time for each test. And if you don't want to do that, for example, for an expensive service to create or something like that, you can use the add shared annotation, and that will make sure that that instance field of your test class is being held, so that it doesn't create new instances each and every time. Then we talk about features. And so features, this is the core. Basically, this is where you write your test. So this is how where you specify what your test, how it should behave. And the feature declaration is in a string format. So that's already one benefit is that in JUnit, of course, we write some methods. Some people use underscores, you know, to have some kind of spacing to give it the test meaningful name. In Groovy, you just declare a string. And you can also use placeholders. And the code inside features is also quite nice, is that when you write your test, so basically when I'm writing my JUnit test, I always have three separate blocks in my tests, the given, when, and then, that it makes it a little bit more readable. But in the Spock framework, it's labeled, so it's much more readable. I was talking about the blocks, and so basically that's how you define a block. You have a setup block within the test. Don't confuse that with the fixtures. So inside the feature, you have a setup block, and you have an alias for that as well. Actually, I'm never using the setup. I'm using given. So setup and given is the same thing. Then you have a when block where you define the action to take place. And then you have, of course, then where you assert that it meets your expectation. You see an expect block. That expect block is kind of a shortcut. Sometimes you don't want to say given, when, then. You can just say expect and then use that block as well. So for really small tests, it's quite nice. You have, of course, a cleanup block where inside that test method you can do some cleanup. And then you have the where part, and the where part is that data-driven part where we'll look into. Actually, the Spock framework, I was looking for a logo, they don't have one, but they have on GitHub, they are trying to figure out a logo, so I just took this one. So now is the time, the demo time, to look at some code. And what I prepared, that's quite readable. I will put it in presentation mode. So first, I will go to the setup. So basically, for your setup, the only thing dependency you need is the Spock framework core, basically. Beside the core, they have other modules as well. I don't... How do you say that? Explain them right now, but there is more than just the core. And to make sure that they run, so basically, if you add the core, you can, in your source test class, test folder, you can basically run your tests. The only problem is that when you run a Maven test or maybe in your continuous delivery environment, you won't see those test results appearing. So you need to do some setup in Surfire, and basically that's what you see here, right here. We configure the Surfire Maven plugin, and normally it only takes classes ending with tests, and we need to add also classes ending with spec. Of course, you could also write your specifications, that's the way we call the Spock tests, ending with tests, but I think this is a nicer approach because I like to separate my code, especially when they are written in different languages. So basically, that's the setup you need to do. Let me check if I can switch, yes. So what we are going to test is actually quite simple. We have some calculator servers. It's ending some numbers. And of course, we check that we don't pass nil in it. And if the operand's length is greater than zero, you know, just give us the sum back. And otherwise, you can throw a null pointer exception with that specific message. So basically, that's what we want to test. If we look, I was afraid of this already. So basically, we need two test cases to test the nil pointer, so the object requiring on nil and the null pointer exception. And I want also to test that if I give one argument, two arguments, or more. So if we do that in JUnit, I'm gonna, so if you do that in JUnit, basically I'm gonna write what I do most of the time is just using an underscore, you know, to have some kind of meaningful sentence. So basically here we test with different operands, and basically what I use is a parameterized option in JUnit. Of course, this is I'm using here JUnit 4 as a comparison. Of course, JUnit 5 has some other options to do those kind of things, but basically a parameterized test with three test cases, with one operand, two operands, and more than two operands, with some kind of expected result. And just to make life a little bit easier, I just added some test class where I can differentiate between the operands and expected results. You see that I, how do you say that, comment the other two test cases about the null pointer exception, because if I uncomment this, the test will run, but because the test class will be initiated three times, those two null pointer exception tests will be run six times. So we don't want that. That's why we put that in a separate class where we have those error flows tested. So that's nice. Let's look at how it looks in Spock. So the test class is extending the specification class, and here you see my test definition. So I was talking about, okay, it's just using strings, so that's already nice. It's kind of readable what I want to, which kind of behavior I want to test. I have a setup, a when then, and normally what I use is the given. I think it's more meaningful. So those are those two null tests. And here start the interesting data-driven part of it. If you look carefully here, you see that I started here with a hash sign, and that's where I can inject the properties used, and we'll see when I run the test how that looks like. And basically, here you have that expect statement I was talking about. When you don't want to use that given when then, you can just say, well, expect that if you add those operands, that it's equal to the results. And then the where part for the data-driven is where you can put an inline table. So inline tabling is nice, but what if you have 40 test cases you want to do, then the inline part becomes quite cumbersome. It's still readable, but it's quite cumbersome. Basically, what you can do as well, and I put it here, is that you can use, this is a Groovy feature, by the way, where you can provide an iterator. So basically, the input could be a table, for example, in a database, or it could be an Excel file or CSV or whatever. So you have more options than just using the inline table. And that unroll annotation you see here, that's what's going to be used to fill the operands and the result part when running the test. So I will run those tests. Let me check. And I was talking about, well, the reporting is quite nice. And if we look at our JUnit tests, we have, well, a test 0, 1, and 2 has been run. If we look how the Spock framework is giving us a very, very nice explanation of what has been tested. So that's one part of the better reporting, but it gets even better. I have 1 minute left, so I want to show you that as well. Let's create a test fails. So this, of course, won't return three. And we're going to do the same thing in Java. Here, somewhere there. Let's run both tests. So two tests should be failing if it's working nicely. So JUnit, like you're expecting, well, it says, you know, expected 6, actual 3. What's the cause? We don't know, but if you debug it, we can see what's happening. And if we look at the failing test in the Spock framework, you get a really nice assertion what's going on, where you have some specification saying, well, you know, the add method returned 3, the operands given was 3 and 3, and your expected result was 3. So you have a lot more information about what's going on. Here we immediately know, of course, this is a very trivial sample, you immediately know what's going on. I'm going to try to get out of this one. So, like I said, I would show you some table between Spock and JUnit. So the setup and the cleanup already discussed, setup spec before spec, so all those familiar JUnit annotations on the other side. And well, the data-driven feature, they say here theory. I must admit, I never use theory, so I don't know how that is working. Most of the time I use the parameterized tests. You have a test expected, but in our tests, in the Groovy tests, we can really assert the message as well. We don't have to do a try catch and then get the message and try to assert if the message is what you expected. So that's basically my talk about the Spock framework. Are there any questions? No questions? Then. Oh, one question.
I always see those small examples.
Yeah.
Looks like behavior.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yes, you can. So you can use them. So basically, I'm going to repeat your question because it's quite interesting. So the question is, this is a small example. Like, of course, especially in a quickie, I have to use a small sample. But is it also usable for behaving real behavior-driven development? So I think you were referring a little bit like Cucumber, for example, something like that. Yes, you can, because here I use it in a unit test for my features. But of course, instead of calling my service, I could do, for example, I use it a lot in my Spring Boot application, where I do I take a REST template and just do a call, so to do a black box test. So yes, that's possible. But it's not like Cucumber, where you have some test specification and you have some glue code, you know, what is referring to it. This is the code is inside your test. Any other questions? Then I want to thank you for your time.